Hey kids, Mark Miller here. Welcome to another episode of Code Rush. Roy's going to be joining us in just a little bit. And we're going to, in the meantime, I think we're going to just write a little bit of code before we get into the main stuff today. That's what I think we're going to do. I want to send some messages out whenever we advance the clock. That's what I want to do. So I'm kind of looking at the clock advance calls here. They go down to the game engine and call advance on it. But there's also a somewhere in here, there's an update clock right around there. And that sends a signal R connection to actually update the clock that you see over here to my right. And when we send it down, we send down this clock DTO, which looks like this. And I think what I want to do, let's take the back overlay. Yeah, let's do this. We'll move this over so we can see the code this way. What I want to do is I think I want to add a message that I want to send down sometimes. For example, when we go into combat, I want to see right over here by the clock, I want to see combat, you know, or entering combat or exiting combat, something like that. So I want the message to pop up and kind of float up right there. So I'm going to add a new property here called message, like that. That's in clock DTO. Over here in the overlays, here I've got the DTO right here, and I think I want something like this. If, if DTO.message, then I want to, like this, something like this, this.show. Clock message. Sorry again, I just realized it's blocked over there and I've shut down the app so I can't take that away. So just work on this side. Show the clock message, passing that string. Then I want to declare that. Message of type string. Like that. It's going to return a void. Now we want to work with animated text. Do I have any in here? Any examples of it? Let's use Code Rush to animated element. Some text effects. Let's go back over. Where did we make our change? We were in Dragon Game. Huh. I was kind of expecting us to be lower. I don't want this happening in both places. Is kind of what I don't want to have happen. Let's get rid of this and let's say update clock from DTO. What's that look like? That's right there, protected. Do I have anybody overriding that? I got a back game and that's it. No front game. I'm going to throw it in the front game. I'm going to throw an override of this in the front game right here. We'll just duplicate this right here. To add that line that I've got in the clipboard here. Let's get to the front game. How do I call the base? I forget. Super, right? Super. Super Dot. That's what it is. So we'll call the Super, even though we know now it's not doing anything. And then we'll call this dot show clock message. Let me drop a marker here and look for any kind of animated text effects, anything like that. Text effect, sweet. Okay. Add floating player text. Here comes Roy.
Hello.
Hey, buddy. How you doing?
Not too bad.
Good.
End of another work day, start of another work day.
Yeah, okay. Don't be mad.
No. This works much more fun.
Okay. Good. Well, I'm glad to hear that.
How you doing?
I think I'm doing okay.
Excellent.
I'm adding some floating player text. We're going to get into our Google Sheets thing in a second, but you were like, while you were out there, I was thinking, I don't want to start this till Rory's here. So this adding floating player text is kind of what I want to call.
Okay.
I get to select.
In what sense is it floating?
What'd you say?
In what sense are we floating?
It's the text that, like, if you know, the plus five gold or plus, you know, five
oh,
hit points.
Yeah, yeah.
The text that comes up
okay.
from the player. So it's basically just comes from the bottom, which is exactly what I want for the clock. And that's what I need to do there. So let's go back here. And in show clock message, I think I'll really. Well, do I have this? It's down here. Let's paste and we'll move that up because we don't need that here anymore. We're going to come down here, show clock message, and then we're going to say this dot, and our X position is probably going to be, that's about 19, that's about 18, 1820. I'm gonna say it's 100. About where the nine is in the middle of the clock. I'm estimating that's about it's about 80 to 100 pixels somewhere in that space. So maybe say 1830. The text is going to be message. The font color. I want it to match the clock. So forgive me for a second while I take a screenshot of that and start up my imaging app, which the downside is the imaging app takes about a minute to start up.
Okay.
My least favorite, you know, feature about the imaging app. It's one of my least favorite features. It's one of those things where I've been using it for years, and this is PaintShop Pro from Corel. And unfortunately, I don't have a lot of great things to say about their progress over the years. It used to be incredibly fast to start up, and then got worse over time. I actually like it more than Photoshop for the most part, but it has performance problems with large files. Anyway, I've pasted a screenshot over into it. I'm just moving it across all my monitors using the Windows left and right arrow keys. So I bring it up here. Oops, wrong thing copied to the clipboard. Let's try one more time. That's what I want on the clipboard. Try pasting it here. Good, good, good. It's my OBS. And I just want to come in here and I want to grab these colors to see what they are and what we're dealing with. That'll be my text color. Grab it there. And my outline color is gonna be maybe somewhere in this space, right there. Like that. Semicolon there, I think we're good. And so that's how we can send the message. So if there's a message specified, then we're good to go. I think I can refresh that. That is in the front overlay. Might not hurt to also refresh the back overlay.
Yeah.
Refresh both of those caches. I'm going to do this live on the stream. Back overlay is here. Refresh that. Now, I need to send this message out. Right now, I'm not doing anything with that. Where's clock DTO used? Here we go. All right, so here's what I want. I hate using fields to solve this problem, but unfortunately, because I've got the everything's decoupled, my next best solution, my field solution, is a not bad solution. So I'm going to say, I'm going to create a field called clock message, like this, and I'll set it to null. Well, it's already set to null, so I don't need to worry about that. So there's my clock message. And then when we create the DTO that we send down for signal R, I'm going to say message is equal to clock message. And then, comma. And then I'm going to clear clock message. I'm going to set it to null. There's a cool code rush template. If I've got something on the clipboard, just SN like that, and it'll set it to null. That's what it will do right there. Okay, cool. So now my clock message is going to be restored back to nothing at the end. So I'm only going to send it once. I do that whenever I update. So the reason I'm doing this is I'm doing this in a field is because my update clock is decoupled from my advance clock. But in my advance clock calls, I kind of know when what's happening and what the message should be. So here, for example, in advance turn, I'm going to say this plus, equals plus one round. So my clock is going up by one round. Does that make sense? Because in Dungeons & Dragons, each round is 6 seconds long. So I'm going to send just that out. Let's look at other calls to advance in here. Plus one day. Like that. Let's do this. I'm going to mark this. I'm going to select holding copy to the clipboard, and I'm going to come down here and paste it. And now Coders is highlighting the piece I want to change. Although, in this case, I actually want to just add a zero right there. 10 days. Come down here, though, and paste again. Plus 1 month. Dungeons & Dragons, every month is 30 days long.
If you're going to invent a calendar, then make life easy on yourself.
It's nicely done. Plus 1 hour. Down here, plus 10 minutes. Got to get a zero right there. And this one right here is plus 1 minute. And let's see, anything else I need to worry about? I don't think I'm going to play in this space. These are buttons that the Dungeon Master... it's a to-do, I think. To-do. Calculate. Clock message. Based on the delta here. Okay? There's that awesome coloring that that our good friend Surly Dev suggested for my to-do notes. Mm-hmm. Alright. And I think that's it. Let's see. Any other advances in here I need to worry about? It's just advances the date by a certain number. Then we're in our test cases. More test cases. Resting. Here we're going to do this. We're going to say, resting. I think, or should I just have it plus? I think I'll do that instead. The resting is something the Dungeon Master can say out loud. And that's it, we've cycled around. So now if we run this, and we refreshed both the other streams down below, there's a shot all of this is gonna work.
I like that kind of possibility.
Yeah. That's, That's what we're dealing with here. Okay, we're up. Initializing player data. It should get rid of the text. And it did. And now let's say add 10 minutes. Okay. Not bad.
That seems like what we're after.
It seems like what we're after. It's just too far to the right.
Indeed.
And,
that's just the estimate of the 1830, right?
Yeah. The thing is, though, is it grows as it goes up.
Sure, extra digit, maybe for larger quantities of time.
Yeah, this is what I kind of wanted to do. I think I wanted to do. Let me refresh the front page here again. Let's reinitialize the data. Let's say add 10 minutes. That's not bad. I don't mind it going off screen as long as it's on screen for when we see it. Add a short rest. It's 2 hours. Nice. Enter combat. Oh, I don't think I did the enter combat, exit combat. I wanted that. Let's see what we can see here. Combat. Enter combat. I think I want something here. And maybe something here. Let's see. So I'm going to click on enter combat. Did not get to the breakpoint. So this is coming from something else, I think. Yeah. All right. Let's do this. Oh, we've got multiple musics playing here. And a third one. An explosion. Hey, Cobus Alpha, welcome, buddy.
Welcome, Cobus Alpha.
Yeah, that's some awesome music, isn't it? That is the one of my favorites that I can listen to all the time. All right, here's where we're going down here. I think I want my breakpoint there, and I want my breakpoint here. And let's do it again. Exit combat. Okay, so now I want to say clock message is equal to. I'm not sure if there's going to be something here. But here I think I'm going to have a message that says combat.
Mm-hmm.
Like that.
So now what we're going to have is something visual on screen as well as the sound. Which,
right.
You know, it's that dual right. Senses kind of thing that really sort of hopefully puts you in that particular.
Right. And there's actually there's a lot of research that I've found in studying science of great design that shows that if you send the same message on several channels at once.
Yeah.
You'll it'll click and be retained more and be understood and grokked faster. I don't know if I want to have the word normal. Out of combat is a lot of words.
Return to peace, or I don't know.
Yeah.
Peace can even be suggested. I don't know. That's true.
Peacetime.
Peacetime, maybe. Yeah.
It's cool.
Cobase Alpha says you could also punch the viewer in the face. Would sure. That the technology would allow that?
Oh, it'll allow it. All right, that's what I'm going to do. It's cool in combat. So, it's cool. Love it. I actually love that. Enter combat.
That's right, combat's finished. Three of the players are lying dead on the floor, but it's cool.
Yep. Now, the only other thing I think I want to do is check to see, let's advance the round, see what happens there. Plus one round, not bad. Um, Actually, I think I'm tracking the round number. I should show what round we're in. Round one, round two, that sort of thing. Round. It's my combat music there, Rory. Okay, here we go. I think I know what round I'm in. Somewhere. But not here, though. Where's the round advance? Let's take a look at this. In the game. Curly's Alpha says Overkill Projections should release the fully immersive D&D combat experience in a box as a new PC peripheral. Yeah. Sure.
Previous comment about boxing glove on a spring.
Yeah, no, I got it. Absolutely. This is exact. I have no. You think you're joking, but we're not joking. This is serious. Yes, this is serious, honey. Okay. This is developer talk over here. Let the developers be alone in our developer world, please.
With our explosions.
She's like, why don't you go refactor yourself, she said. Go get yourself refactored. I think I should be calling advanced round. It's private, but I think I should be. I'm closing down my main window. I'm going to make this public like that. Then I'm going to call advanced round on the game when we manually respond to that button being hit, which is... Where is it? Ah, it's not there. Let's go look for plus one round. Did I delete it? It wasn't there.
Mark, you deliberately using a coding window that is half the width of the screen.
Yeah, I was doing that because we had stuff. Thanks for that, Rory. It's better now. Yeah. Okay. Here's what I want to call it. I want to say game.advance. Round. We're going to do that. The advanced round, is this going to come back to us? Look at that. We're doing that right there.
Twice.
Yeah, so I'm not
there a month from now.
So I'm not going to do this. Okay? We call game.advanced round. Totally fine. Like that. But now I want
to... inherently knows internally that that means 6 seconds, which is quite nice. It's a good encapsulation.
Yeah. So now what I want to do is I want to say round. Come on, where are you? Dollar sign. There you are. And I think it's going to be game round. I think the game is going to tell us keep track of the round. I've got a round index. I think that's it. Plus one. Start round, it goes to zero. Advance round, it goes up one. Okay.
So, by the time you finish a typical Sunday of advanced D&D, how high do we expect that value to be? Is that an absolute across the session, kind of an index?
No. This is only during battle.
Okay. So there's a fixed number of rounds.
Yeah, start round is called the beginning. But however, there's some events going on here. This I don't want in this space. Because look at this. If you go into advanced round and you're on round starting, we go to the round starting event. We invoke that. Ooh, which is not handled yet. All right, let's start handling that. That inner combat is handled. No? What? Didn't make any sense. Request a message to Dungeon Master. That's handled, I bet. There we go. All right, let's hook up to that other one. Interesting. Those other ones. Wait, what was it? I wanted round starting. That. Game round starting. And then I want to come in here and I want to say, hey, clock message is equal to that round. Right there. What's in my EA? Do I have a game reference in there? Should I use that one instead? I do. I'll use that one instead. They're both essentially the same. Okay, cool. So now it's going to say round, space, and then the round number we're in whenever the round starts. You know, assuming all that
code goes. Codebase Alpha has an interesting suggestion. It says Fred should hold up a card with round number X on it. It's like one of the, I don't know what you call them, the...
No, I know.
In between boxing rounds.
Yeah.
Or what have you, or whoever puts that sign up. That's an interesting idea. Yeah. But you did say something about being able to give players, and I'm assuming NPCs as well, the ability to type messages and have kind of thought bubbles above themselves.
I do wonder.
An interesting form of communication, especially for Fred, who is somewhat less than verbal about some of his communications.
What? What did you say, Rory?
Was that a slightly roundhouse's way of saying that?
He says, I'm going to get you. Look at him. He's saying that right now. What are your plans for Rory, Fred? Not saying what his plans are. Okay. What do we got here? Let's enter combat here. Let's enter some combat. Let's also show where we left off yesterday. Okay, so there's entering combat. You should have seen the combat piece come up. Oh, I wanted to do one other thing. So we're not seeing round one yet, but I don't know if I should say round one instead of entering combat or not, but I think I'm just going to do that. I didn't look at the clock, to be honest. Cornelia is going to do something. She's going to enter wild shape. So we were working on this yesterday. I should have shown you this. I just clicked on enter wild shape from here. It did this. Let's exit wild shape for a second. All right, here's the button. Notice this is all coming from that feature. So we have a button here and a button here, but their visibility changes depending on state. And that was all set up based on expressions we added to our Google Sheet. So yep. Entering the frame may be more evocative than entering combat. I think you're right, but the problem is I have a small amount of space over where the clock is for words. So I'd have to change it so that the text would kind of move, you know, towards the center of the screen. So all the text was on screen as it grew. I could do that, but I wanted to get this done quickly this morning, so before we went on to the other piece. So enter wild shape, when I click on it, that disappears and exit wild shape is here. This is automatically taken care of because it's a rechargeable, because of that line of code we entered in the spreadsheet. Let's bring that up here.
So in theory, when you exit wild shape, you'll no longer be able to enter wild shape simply because you've used both your charges.
Right, exactly. And so that whole thing was defined through a couple things. One is the words wild shape here inside of the features. Both Cornelia and Melanie have wild shape. Then what else? In features, the wild shape feature, we declared it there, and it requires activation. Its activation time is one action. Its deactivation time is a bonus action. We've got the text to display here on the activate shortcut, and the text to display when we exit, when we deactivate it. We have also, you know, when we were talking yesterday, Rory, when you're here, I was like, well, we don't need a separate context to know when the deactivate shortcut is available, because it's simply the opposite of this. And then, as luck would have it, I realized, or whatever, we ran into it, that situation where it was, that was not true. That the activation is only available if the number of wild shapes we've used is less than two.
Oh.
Right? As soon as we've used two, we can't, you know, this is no longer available. Well, does that, you know, and the opposite logic is, doesn't make sense for this one. So we have two different logics for when the buttons can be appear. So one.
So some things will have direct opposites, but some things will not.
Yeah.
To explicitly place these values in there.
Yeah. Take wild shape, perhaps. I love it. Way better. Let's do it. Take wild shape. Restore normal shape.
Yeah.
You know, we could do this so easily because it's all data. So later today, we're going to try and actually access this sheet, I think.
Yeah.
That's what we're trying to do.
That's up.
we're going to be, all those database bullies at school that made fun of me because I didn't know databases. By the end of the day, they're going to get their comeuppance and they're going to regret ever being mean to me.
Either that or they'll be looking at the huge pile of crazy we've dug ourselves into.
Really? Really, that's your line you're going to say right now? Karen's like, you always promised comeuppance, but you never did deliver comeuppance. Oh, they'll get their comeuppance, Karen. They'll rue the day they tried to get my milk money. They will rue. Those database bullies are so mean, Roy.
Yeah.
Right? They're like, give me your milk money, kid. You don't know databases. I got a stored procedure for you right here, kid. Give me your milk money. That's what they say. Kobe's office are like, wait, what? Oh, no, wait, that was you. Sorry, that was you, Roy. I hear Roy's an expert with the Google API. Well, that's awesome. Cool. We called add rechargeable. That sweet little bit of code gave us this right here. How many we get per day, right? Including the refresh on it, right? Which is we get two every short rest. So if we come in here and we say we were to exit combat and take a short rest, cool. What else do we do? This is just some, housekeeping code right here to manage the wild shape, to track how many wild shapes we've used. We're just offsetting by ones, which means we're incrementing this. We're setting that we're in the wild shape. That's our state. And this was a really cool thing we did. Add timer. So we give it a unique name. It's, Cornelia's Druid Wild Shape. We set a time in seconds. So we say Druid Wild Shape hours times second per hours. What's going on with that? Look over at properties. Seconds per minute is 60. Seconds per hour is seconds per minute times 60. So we're just drilling in. It's kind of like we're defining these kind of global constants, I guess, in some way, or global properties. And some of them are calculated. These are all calculated on the fly. Some of them are table lookups, things like that. Druid Wild Shape hours is half of the level of the Druid. Round it down. So this half function we created, right?
The great part about this approach is that none of this is hard baked into the compiled exercise. We could take all of this away, throw in an entirely different set of data. We could have space marines on a ship in the future kind of role-playing kind of thing, and it would still work.
I feel like we're building something valuable.
Yeah.
Right? It's like the more I use it and it doesn't have problems, right? The more I use it and it like is solid, the more I'm like, I'm like, oh, I'm liking this, right? I'm liking this.
I've always defined a program, or at least explained one of our attributes, is a type of person who is willing to put extraordinary levels of effort into being lazy.
Yeah.
So we put all this effort in so that we can make future us's life that much simpler.
Yeah. I think Codebase Alpha is enthusiastic about the about the Space Marines.
Maybe. Codebase Alpha, if you want to throw us some data sheets, right? We would be able to switch to them very easily. You want to put the effort into the actual data?
Sure. The other thing that's very cool about this is we're able to pass in a function call as a string when that's executed when the timer is done. And that function call is over in our functions. Because it's as if we're brilliant, Rory. Exit wild shape, I just added it, and we're just going to call deactivate feature wild shape. Right? So the feature will deactivate when the time is up. The feature will deactivate when the user executes the bonus action. It's as if we wrote almost everything about the feature, with the exception of calling the two pieces remaining are select your creature. Right? So we need a creature selector.
Yep.
And the second one is, what is it? It is, now assume all the stats of that creature and the attack options and things like that. So if I were to select that, then that would also happen is all my shortcut buttons would be wiped away and only the ones that were now available to me in that creature form would be available. But I'll show
this
you.
This is more than just a disguise exercise. This is an actual take on the properties of and be able to behave like.
Right, exactly. Yeah, it's more
than
just
pretty useful.
Yeah, no, it is cool because the other thing that's cool about wild shape is when your stats go down to zero, then your hit points for that shape go down to zero. You go back to where you were before you started in terms of hit points.
So in reality, that stuff over and above what you started with, in a sense, because you'll just return to what you were.
It is. It's a lot like temporary hit points. What are you doing in the UK, babe? Yeah, you're right. That's because I was going to give you some kisses and I didn't want any kids to come in. It's all right. She's just like, you lock the door. This is Karen right here. She's just showing, she's feeling well enough to show you the top of her head. Is that a tiara you're wearing right there? Okay. All right. I love you.
Karen's not actually that sure. It's just that Mark's got himself raised up on a pedestal.
Yeah. Rory feels like it's a good time to tell everybody that. All right. Check it out. What else do we have here? Activation message. First name is changing into wild shape. Is taking on his/her wild shape. She can select any creature she has seen of challenge rating. And then we get to set out the challenge rating, which we worked on yesterday. Mm-hmm. On deactivate. Cool. That's all cool. We removed the timer.
Something about the flexibility of this system. Now, admittedly, we did say, and we should be clear on this, we don't yet have... Actually, we do have a lot of data on creatures and adversaries, but we don't necessarily have a list of the ones seen recently to pick from. But if we did, we could put a list of those up in a choice box, as we've seen before, have DM or whoever choose the one on their behalf, and then we can automate everything through from there. So you can see how the pieces of this build up very effectively.
They do. Something else I want to show you. Check this out. Before player rolls dice... This event is only called when this feature is active. So I've just added add trailing effects, add die roll effects using wild animal form as strengths for both. These refer to two different effects on two different pages. I've got my trailing effects page, wild animal form, puts a paw print out and uses the left-right distance and forward-bin-forward distance between prints, these two values here, to put paw prints out in left-right values behind the die. Okay. Die roll effects, wild animal form, does on first contact sound, it just plays a wild form thing. So it's like a growl, a snarl. That's all it does. You could do other things, like you can add first contact effects like a smoke explosion or something like that. Right? You can add halo effects, all kinds of, you know, things, rotation effects, all kinds of stuff. That's a rotation on whatever this effect is here.
Genesis, where are you? We need your help.
We do need your help, Genesis 7. You're going to help us today? We're going into Google Sheets in a second, kids. Genesis 7 is just in time. Get him, Genesis 7.
You'll
get
have
him.
All the options. Get him.
All right. So I wanted to show that, though. So that means now, if Cornelia... Notice the clock has stopped this whole time we've been talking because we're in combat. If Cornelia does a dice roll, like, for example, with her... quarterstaff, maybe her club. Actually, let's do this. Let's complicate things. Let's cast Shillelagh. It's a bonus action. Let's cast it on her club. Boom. Now let's bring the club up. Presuming that in her wild form shape she could use the club. Now she's got a magical club. Bonus 1d8 instead of the 1d4 I think it had before. Right? And let's roll the attack. You should see that wild animal form attack and hear the growl as the dice roll. Let's try it. There you go. And the dice, the paw prints are in her color, right? The same kind of color that she's got. Very cool, right? All of that done.
All of these little nuances really adding to the immersion and style factor.
Yeah. And they're all done in the code. Now, we're still in round one. I want to test the advanced round. So I'm going to go over here, and I'm going to pull out my dagger, and I'm going to roll an attack here with the dagger. Okay. When we switch back to Cornelia...
Maximum damage!
Yes,
fickle spin.
And we do something. We should see a round one when she does something. Let's see if we do ice knife, roll the damage on that. There's round one right there. So we're back to we're wait that should have been round two.
Hmm.
That's upsetting. Roll the damage. Yeah, it should have been round two.
Lady.
Let's bring up Lady's tenderizer and roll the attack. Go back to Cornelia again.
Bitch. It's Wickles, bitch.
And spider climb. Round two, yeah. The round's off by one.
It's as if we're announcing the end of a round.
It's weird. The game round starting. Round starting.
It's not initialized. Mind you, we didn't get a round zero, did we?
On round starting. Round index there. It doesn't make sense. This should be a one by the time the event is called here. Is round index ever set to a negative one? I don't understand why it's off. What's round offset? Tell DM in rounds. What's going on there? All right, you know what? I'm not going to worry about it now, Rory. I'm just going to make a note for myself that I got to go look at this because I want to get into the other thing we said we were going to do.
Yep.
Okay. All right, so let's do that. Let's set up, let me just make a note to myself. Round number text needs to be checked. Round numbers seem to be off by one. Plus, I want to get the colors. I want to change the colors of the message depending on whether we're in combat or not. If we are in combat, so I want it like red text coming up if we're in combat. Okay, that's that. Next, here we go, kids. Comprehensive access to spreadsheets. Quick start. Not Python.net.
Nope, not Python. That would really be pushing things a little far, wouldn't it?
All right, let's do this, kids. You ready? I'm going to
name. This is the API V4. Yeah? Which means that they must be pretty good at it by now, right?
Yeah. Yeah, you're right. Right there. There's the V4 right there. Okay, I'm going to do it. I'm a little scared to click it, Roy. This is, we're committing. I'm also scared to click it on this page because I'm like, you know, what kind of data is going to show up in
well,
this next moment.
Well, one presumes this is going to enable it for the user that you are currently logged into Google Sheets as. And since that's the one editing these Google Sheets, then that would make sense.
Yeah, I just want to, let's see what happens here. I'm going to be like, configure your OAuth client is coming up. So I'll show you what I see. There it is right there. It's a desktop app. But really, really big dialogue for this one question. I wonder if there's other stuff that shows up if I do this. Okay, there we go. That's why it's so big. All right. They have nothing to say to me for a desktop app. Look at that. They're like, you are on your own, sucker.
Okay. You could be anywhere.
Yeah. Let's see what else comes up now. Well, that's really funny. Rory, you said that, Rory. The hardest thing in dev comedy, coming up with the third thing in that list.
Yeah.
Naming X off by one errors. It's really
because it's a great joke. The two hardest things in coding, naming things, cache invalidation, and off by one errors. Quite rightly so, Codebase Alpha. Every time I hear that joke, though, the middle item is different. There's always naming. Obviously, the point is the off by one errors. But X, that second thing in the list, it's always different.
Right,
depends on where you come from in the first place, I suppose.
So I have to be very careful what I'm doing here. Check this out.
Oh, yeah.
There's a secret on this page I can't show you. But it says, there's my client ID. I probably shouldn't show you that. Well, I guess I'll show it to you. Who knew? No, it probably won't cause too much problem. And then there's secret stuff. Okay? Mm-hmm. So I'm going to click on the download client configuration. And now it's asking, where do you want it? And I think I should also, right now, let's go in and let's start a new instance of Visual Studio. Boom! We're spinning up a new instance of Visual Studio, kids. Here we go.
You can never have too many of those.
I'm going to create a new project.
Okay. So this is going to be our experimental let's try something.
Yeah.
Or go straight into all the damage.
Yeah. We're going to get our feet wet. we're gonna splash around, and then we're gonna see what happens. Should I put it there? Why not? I guess why not? I'll do that. I'll put it there. Call it. We're gonna call this Google Sheets test. Looks like that's one too many E's. Google Sheets test one. And let's hit create there. All right, now I want to, I'm gonna save that other file there. It's called credentials.json. That's what's happening there. So I'm gonna save that file.
That's the kind of file you do not want to put into the Git repository.
Yep, that is correct. So that file's out there now. All right, let's see what else is. What is Google? Where's my? Did I close? Looks like I closed down the. Oh no, there it is. It just showed up. Weird.
I was gonna say the only other possibility is you're done, finished, which feels like leaving us just hanging there.
There you go. Okay, so step one, turn it on. I did that. Save the file. I did that. Step two, prepare the project. Create a new Visual Studio, Visual C Sharp console application project in Visual Studio. I'm like, I did that, sucker. I did it.
You did that. You're ahead of the game.
B, I'm going to skip step B. Because you know why? I don't know what this is. I don't do these kinds of command line things. I'm like
I know a GUI that can help us there.
That's what I'm going to do. We want Google APIs Sheets version 4. So I'm going to do that instead. Wait, where'd my app go? It's way down over here. Hold on. There's my app. So we're going to bring up the NuGet Package Manager. Manage. There it is right there. We're going to hit Browse, and we're going to say Sheep. There.
First option.
Look at that.
There we go.
Wait, how did you say first before me? Did you try that already?
I may have tried this about 20 minutes ago.
Oh, look at you, man. You're saving us.
I did not get very far beyond this.
We are on rails, apparently. Rory knows everything about the Google Sheets API. He's
look, shortly in the distance where the rails completely run out.
All right, here we go. Yeah, Rory's a cheat, says Codebase Alpha. Yeah, come on, Rory. You gotta go.
I was quite happy when Bart picked this particular direction because it was the only one I'd gone in.
All right, well, because here's the thing, man, you know. So you kind of got to meet me halfway, Rory.
Okay.
You got to meet me halfway.
I know someone with Jack.
Yeah. Right, Fred? Right?
As close as we get, but there you go.
Fred says yes. You got to meet me halfway.
Fred's in favor.
I'm going to say install. Install that sucker. Here we go.
Yep. Who knows what NuGet's going to put in the project now? Look at all those things.
I don't care. I'm just, happy.
At least we didn't have to put them there, right? That's the benefit here.
Yeah, I'm a happy coder. All right, so I did that. I think I just did step B. And I'm like,
yep.
There you go, Google. I don't need to follow your instructions. You're not the boss of me. Set up the example. Drag credentials.json into your Visual Studio Solution Explorer. Okay. I can do that.
How you do that, because it may display it at the same time.
Oh, yeah. So let's do this. Yeah, I got to be very careful about that. Open folder in File Explorer. There's that. Let me just drag this off screen for a second. Make sure. There's my credentials, JSON. It's interesting. It's already showing up, actually. I'm going to throw it in anyway. Weird. It picked it up already. When I went in,
okay.
Weird. It's totally weird. Oh, Jesus, really? Really?
So...
Son of a...
Not 15 seconds ago, I swear.
Really? All right, the cool thing is... Hold on. Did you just blow everything? Was it on screen or was it off screen?
I may have seen things on Skype.
Nope, the secret was off screen.
It was
off screen, yeah. Doxed! I know, Codebase Alpha. This is me. I'm just trying to be, cool and chill on this whole thing. And I don't know, somehow maybe I clicked something or Visual Studio is like, let me be helpful and open it up for you. Right? It was so funny. It was like there. It was like, I thought everything was good because I just dragged it over again anyway on top of it. And it was like, I'll open it up. But I checked it. The secret was far off on the right side of the screen. So I think we're good. Hopefully, just don't click, double click that. All right. So
this is that wonderful preview file that sometimes happens in Studio, right?
I'm so scared.
You mean this one that desperately wanted to see?
Get a new one as we saw it. Are you sure you saw it? No, I don't think so. I don't think you saw it. I saw
something, but it may not have been the secret.
I opened the same file in my much wider monitor, and I couldn't see it. It was off screen. It was, the secret was on one line. It was one line far off screen. I had to scroll off to the right, so I just think there's no way you saw it. That's my take on it. Okay. Let's see here. Modifying
now to the music.
Okay, wait. Copy to output directory field and copy always. So again, I'm like crazy nervous right now, just right-clicking this.
Hit F4 instead, you get the properties window. Oh, it depends on settings, I suppose, but yeah.
Okay. Copy to output folder. Copy always. Right? That's what they said to do?
Now, logically, this is because we're now going to put this in the same directory as the executable itself. So that would be maybe in a debug folder somewhere as we're running it normally.
Yeah.
And we want to make sure it's there so that that executable that we're about to provide the code for can find said credentials.
Yeah. Replace consoles of program with following code. No copy, it looks like.
Here's one we made earlier.
Right, let's just do this.
This is good.
Yeah, you think it's good? Music's
well,
good.
The way I figure it, we've got a working example in front of us. We haven't proven it's working, but if it doesn't work, it's actually not our fault. It's Google's. Mm. They tend to be okay at doing this sort of thing. So
right.
Something should work, right?
And are they going to say, run the sample?
It'll what do you think the sample's going to do?
The sample will attempt to open a new window or tab in your default browser. If this fails, copy the URL from the console manually opening in your browser. Okay. If you're not already logged into your Google account, you'll be prompted to log in. Okay, click the accept button. The sample will proceed automatically.
Let's be clear here. We're not actually doing anything with Sheets so far, other than asking for permission in a clever way.
Well, I think we're reading. Let's look at the code here. Yeah, let's look at the code actually over in Visual Studio here. Look at their code. They're using this kind of funky style here. Here, we're getting the values from this range.
Okay, so that is definitely a request.
Yeah, I think that class data is the name of the sheet within the document. I suspect if we were to open up that document, this is the spreadsheet.
So here's my question: if we have just started up, do we have the sheet that they're going to try and read from? Did they add that sheet to your account as part of the sign-up process? Is that what it is?
That's interesting. No, I have a feeling that this is I imagined that they created a new kind of Google Sheet document that if you get a link to it and you access it, it's like a template. It just copies a version for you. That's what I imagined, how I imagined they would solve this problem. I'm reading a sample file. Code this alpha. We're going to write out the name and the major, and then we're going to write down all the values from it. So it's basically going to write those into the console. That's it. Here we go. Run.
So it should be launching something in your browser.
It's kind of. Maybe we'll see. Yep, there's the browser piece right there.
Choose an account. Do you have the odd account or two there, Mark?
Just a little bit there. All right.
It reminds me of my list.
The app isn't verified, it says. Hold on, let me go show you that. Right there. So we're going to go into advanced and say go to quick start. I'm safe. Is it quick start? Oh, that's the app. That's the shield. Give quick start permission to view your sheets. Allow. Yeah, allow. Make sure you trust Quick Start.
So is Quick Start the thing you downloaded as a result of running this, or is Quick Start our application?
Quick Start is the name of their sheet, I think. And so now it just did this. credential file saved.
Definitely got some data.
Now, the cool thing about the credential file being saved is that the next time we run it, it's not going to ask. It's going to say, yeah, okay. But I think if we ask for greater permissions, it's going to ask. Because right now we have read-only permissions on this. So this is the name and the major right here. So that's the data right there. Now the question is, okay, so we can close the window. Close it. All right. So not bad. Control C to get out of here. I guess my current question is, how do I get one of those tokens to open up my own file?
Yeah, you need some kind of an identifier for the sheet that you care about.
I'm hitting Control C. I can't close the app. Yeah. No data found and read. Oh, so it's looking for an inner.
Is it still Control C since Windows 10 updated and allowed that to be a clipboard?
What is going on? Oh, yeah, interesting. I don't know.
They're just doing a read line at the end, you just hit enter.
It's a read, is what they're given.
Oh. That should just be identified.
Yeah, I don't understand it.
Yeah, sure enough.
It's a read. Anything should have worked. A version not supported, unknown error. Okay, so I stopped it, did a break call, and then I tried to do a run, that didn't work. That's weird. We'll change it to read line. And, okay, so let's see how we can change this. Read write. Spreadsheet ID. How do we get a spreadsheet ID from our spreadsheet? That's what I'm looking for.
Let's take a look at the URL of our spreadsheet. See if it identifies anywhere in there. Does it self-identify? ID equals or something.
Could it be that?
I mean, it's a guess. Let's be clear. We're going to need to have... I'm going to get a higher def look at this.
Wait, let me try this. Let me grab this.
Could be.
And let me try throwing it here.
Have a quick look. If you look at the code again, see that URL is docs.google.com/spreadsheet/d. You're doing the reverse, aren't you? You're taking that ID, pasting it back. No, absolutely.
Wait.
The evidence is there. If you look at the comment that has a URL in it, it shows their use of a code, which was the previous code. So, yeah, pretty much we can switch.
Yeah, we weren't afraid till you got here. Pudding says, never fear, Pudding is here. Okay.
I think you're right, Mark. I think it is that code in the URL.
All right, let's grab it. Get that document ID in here. Let me undo that. Here's our document ID.
So we're reading from the... Which particular sheet is this? What's the name of this one?
This one is the D&D, just called D&D.
Okay.
And the reason I called it just D&D is when I save these, the default name is going to be in D&D dash and then the name of this page, which is what I wanted to save the files at.
Fair enough. Of course, it's the same sheet regardless. I keep forgetting that these are not distinct sheets in the sense of the different files.
Right.
It is one sheet which contains many tabs,
yeah.
Each of which translates to a single CSV when we download them.
Yeah, so now what I want to do is the range. You know what I want to do? I want to actually go to theirs. I want to go to their document, and I want to see if I'm right about that class data. Yeah, there it is, right
there
down.
We go.
Whoops, right down there. Can you see it? That's what I was thinking might
that's
be
great.
The case. So, hold on. There you go, right there. How do you get that up there so you can see it? All right. So that's what we're looking at there. So if I want to grab the players, then in our code we need to change this to players.
This is really good. We will have something up and running very quickly at this rate.
Sheet name equal to players. Let's do that. and then we're going to come in here and shoot name right there. There's a dollar sign there, so it's interpolated. And this is the range. A2 to E. What range do I want to take in here as my
from
tag?
Our own sheet? Well, if we were to output the names and the classes, similar kind of thing. So, what range? That's A. I guess it is still 2. That's an interesting question. Are we dealing with a zero index?
Yeah, I think so.
No.
I want to see what it does here for my range. I'm just looking at what it's doing. Okay, shoot too far. Ah, yeah, it's making it really hard to just pull it.
This,
the end of the day.
I think, is reasonable to say, is never easy in any spreadsheet. Excel doesn't seem to do any better a job at allowing you to select.
And now
OpenOffice doesn't do that great either.
All right, did I get it all? I guess it's good. Yeah, it looks like I got it all. So it's
okay. So
AU11.
It's
AU11. It's A2 to AU11.
That sounds reasonable.
Yeah.
So that's what we need specifically to get all the data without the heading or headings downloaded, and then we should be able to just pick out the pieces that we care about.
Yeah, I'm just copying that to the clipboard there. And let's do this. Okay, so there's my player range right there. We're getting it. We're still asking. This time we're asking for read-write access. And we're not going to write anything out in this move, but I just want to see what happens there. and I think what we're going to do is we'll write out what? We're going to write out what you got. You can do A2 to AU. No, I need to get down to 11.
If we say A2 AU, how will it determine the number of rows?
Yeah, I kind of, yeah, that's kind of what I'm thinking. You think it'll,
we have potentially thousands.
Maybe it'll take all the data. I don't know. Maybe that's what he's saying. If I don't specify, which I think could be.
I mean, the other way, if you quickly switch back to the sheet itself, I do know that you can remove a bunch of empty rows if you have any. Again, resolution.
You said
so
just try it. All right, I'm gonna try it.
Yeah, fair enough.
Okay.
What could possibly go wrong?
All right, so there it is. So we're gonna say, I'm gonna say name, and maybe the race. So this is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 is the race column. Gonna do this. Name column. To the 0. Race column is equal to what did I say? 4.
Yeah.
0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. Then I'm gonna come down here in the right line. And we do this. Name column. And this is going to be my race column. No, sorry, not here and here. My bad. Here. Here. Name column and race column. Okay. And then we're going to say name and race. All right. Let's see what happens when we run it.
Now, per your original theory, if you change the rights, we may still have to accept that the those rights are allowed. Go straight to your green line.
Straight out of there. Oh no, it worked!
But we did get the data! There you go.
Wow!
I mean, that's almost total complete success, right?
Yeah. Well, let's see if the read line works. Run on the read line, hit enter. All right, good. That worked. Okay. I feel like we're ready to integrate it. I want to start making some helpers to make this easier.
Yeah.
That's what I want to do. But I'm feeling like we're close to integrating. All right, let's switch back over. Let's do the integration. You ready for that, Rory, or what?
Yeah.
You want to run? I want to run.
I think we're ready to run.
No, I want to run
let's
away.
Let's pick those scissors up now.
Okay, so we're getting out of here. Got our clock burning off to the side over there. First step we need to do is we need to do the app. For the main one, this is where we're going to be talking from.
So, we talk about which application is going to be operating the Google API. Is it not the same one that has your CSV reading going on? So the rest of the application doesn't know we're talking to Google.
Yeah,
we switched.
Yeah, no, I'm with you. I was actually thinking about creating my own application, my own DLL for it, is what I was thinking.
Not a bad plan.
Yeah, our D&D core is what uses the CSV helper, and that's where we want it down there so we can do our.
So you're suggesting a Google helper or Google Sheets helper.
Yeah.
Which is parallel with CSV helper.
Kind of. That's what I'm thinking.
I like that.
However, there's kind of an interdependency on it in that. I want it to be knowledgeable about the D&D core classes, but I want the D&D core to rely upon it, I think, as well. So I'm like, okay, do I need to break it into two DLLs? I think for now what I want to do is I'm just going to stick it in D&D core, play with it, and then realize what I need to do and refactor it. That's my plan.
The only thing is it not difficult? Well, I don't know. Maybe it isn't. I don't use a lot of NuGet, so if you want to remove a NuGet thing you've pulled in, is that easily reversible?
I don't know. I've run into problems and had to work my way out. You actually helped me out of a problem where I did that. Kubik Salva is saying the separate project and the solution. So I guess we'll do that. We'll start with a separate project.
I guess that's a good start point. If we decide, so if we started with the equivalent of Google Sheets helper project, and we do our NuGet stuff into that, and if we decide later that we want to expand the influence that has, we can do so. But it's harder to go the other direction.
Yeah, don't worry, Kobe Self. We're not going to do circular dependencies. We'll break it into two DLLs if we have to. I think what I wanted to look at, though, is I wanted to look at the all items. These tables here, like let's go into... let's go into all players. And we call load data, and it's basically a list of characters. We call load data, we pass it this right here, and then we call CSV data.get. And I think what I want our stuff to look like is Google Sheets .get.
Okay.
Something very similar. And so so this is actually giving a full path name to the CSV. And so we would want to essentially find that part of it, realize that it starts with the D&D. San Nesser is now following. Thanks for the follow, by the way. Realizing it starts with this, then says, okay, it's going to be in a recognized sheet. This is the name of the tab in that, the individual tab in that sheet.
Yep.
And then I wanted to get the data and fill out the character DVOs using reflection. I want to essentially completely replace this is what I want to do. And so
I
don't need to have knowledge of the classes. I can just use reflection because we're passing in the class. Right.
Yep.
If we look at the declaration here, it's just got to be of type object, right? T. There's no constraints on it in CSV
so
data.
So the only information we've seen used in our little example that we don't have is the range. In fact, specifically the width. Okay, because each of those files will have a different number of columns in. I guess, though, we can probably just count the things that the properties on the T that we've got and calculate that forward. So that wouldn't be too bad. Yeah. Do we definitely have a property on the DTOs in each case for each of the columns, or are we currently ignoring some of them?
Whatever we're doing, CSV data, our CSV helper is solving. So whatever they're solving, we're going to solve. I just want to be a swappable, replaceable thing here.
I agree entirely, yeah.
What's interesting is CSV data, I thought was theirs, but it's ours. We wrote this that basically goes in and does all of this.
What's the CSV reader? Is that native.net?
That's there. That's the that's from the NuGet package that I'm loading.
Okay.
Pretty sure. CSV helper, yeah. CSV helper. So that's the NuGet package right there. So that's what I think I want to do.
I think that's entirely doable.
Although, since I do own this class, I could create, I could differentiate it with methods. So I can say get CSV here and rename this to, you know, data module or whatever.
Data provider.
Data provider. And then
get CSV and get Google.
I could also have a registration mechanism somewhere in here where I have two different versions of it that basically just look, the class has got this thing in it is what we're looking for. Although because this is static, we'd have to change it to instance, because you can't do interfaces with static members.
Sure.
All right, so those are different ways to do it. A lot of different solutions. Let's get the thing integrated, and we'll kind of get, when we get here, we'll figure it out. Solution Explorer.
Michael Jolly. He's in the house.
Hey, Michael Jolly. Welcome, buddy.
Welcome, Michael Jolly.
I'm going to take this off screen because I'm dragging my credentials.json inside of here.
Are you going to do this then in an existing project then, Mark, rather than a new project?
I was...
Don't remember which one you wanted to do, was all.
I was doing it in D&D Core is what I was doing.
Okay.
Uh-oh, and it's off screen now. And off screen, I've got two credentials.json. Are they the same? No. How did this show up in my D&D Core twice? It's the same file. Weird. Okay, let me delete it. Now, one of the things that's kind of interesting about in the credentials is it's got a project ID on it.
Yes.
And the project ID says, is a string, and it says quick start, dash, and then a long number.
Okay.
I think I'm going to change that. I'm going to at least change the name quick start to something else. I'm going to call it D&D4. Like that. All right, sorry about that. I've just got the sequence on screen. I'm now getting rid of it. Who's got the smarts? New show concept. Sounds intriguing, Bald Bearded Builder. What's that? Okay, so I've dragged it in.
So if you just change the project name, is it possible that that's being used to identify the incoming request, as in it's from a legit project that's allowed to make these calls?
Yeah, I think so.
In other words, so do you need to go and change that in Google as well?
Yeah, I think I do.
Okay.
I think I do. Hold on, let me drag it off screen again because I have to go click on the file again. So freaking nervous. Nerve-wracking. I have to make sure that we properties it copies it to the output directory always. Okay. That's done. Next, let's bring it back on screen. And I think we create a new class, is what I think we do. Feel good? to you, buddy. All right, so we're going to create a new class. I'm going to call it Google Sheets. With that, I'm going to make it static. How you doing, bald bearded builder? What are you talking about out there? Laughing out loud, that clip. Tell us. Okay, so we're going to do that. It's going to be a static class. And I want something very similar to the get right here. I want something similar to that declaration right there. Now, let's move this to its own file. Validate headers. I don't remember why that's important. Let's go look at that. See where we're passing anything into it. In all procs. That's interesting. I'm not sure why that's necessary. I wonder if it was a temporary thing. That's coming for all procs. Do we even have anything that says procs anymore? We do. Oh, interesting. There are functions that don't return a value.
Okay.
Interesting. So where I put function, hold on. Mike's a wild shape shouldn't have been here. Should have been over in procs. Let's see if that still works. Comma separated value. Where's my data? Page. There's procs. And then let's go to functions here. About procs? No, it's weird. Name and script, I'm not sure what's going on there. I'm not sure why that's different and needed. Functions, the same thing. Spell effects, same thing. I wonder if it has to do... Let's go look inside the declaration. For validate headers. If not validate headers, missing field found. So if there's no header for a given member mapping, you can set your own function. I think we set false to these while we were working on it for some reason. We're like, oh, this will get, you know, if it doesn't find the header, we're okay. I'm not too worried about that for now.
Because the theory is that the header being there and having a name is a way of identifying which member you're going to put this value into in the DTO itself. So
yes.
Tabs that don't have headers need some other mechanization in order to get their data into the right place.
Yeah. So we're going to come in here, and it's going to be a file name that's coming in. What I want to do is I want to say, let's go path. I should use system.io up here. And then come down here and be like path dot get file name without extension. File name only, and bald bearded builder putting shared the clip of Karen breaking the terms of service. Every day that girl breaks the terms of service. What'd you say?
I didn't get the terms of service. I was thinking What, Karen broke Star Trek, the original series?
No. You know, I have to tell you, Roy, I'm like probably one of the only few developers in the world who's on a first name basis with attorneys from major companies around the world. Mark, it's Jim. Oh, Google's attorney, Jim. How you doing? Yeah, we got a problem with you again. So it's like that. Okay, so now we're in this space and we got to do something here. We don't need a text reader anymore. We might need something like this. I don't know. I think I'm going to put more work here is what I think I'm going to do. That's what I think I'm going to do. Okay, let's grab the next. Let's go over, start grabbing some of the data from our other app, which is here on screen now.
Looks probably worth pointing out, we do not yet have a NuGet package installed into this project. So none of the new code we're about to copy across will physically function yet.
You are right. You are correct, sir. I'm putting it in another project, man.
Yeah?
I think I am. Just this, that credentials.json, I now got to drag it somewhere else, and I'm scared to death it's going to pop open again. I'm going to do a new project.
I assume these things can be changed. I mean,
add new project.
Codebase Alpha is very proud of you. It's the right thing to do, he says.
Yeah, I think he's totally right. We're going to call this our Google Sheets project. Sheets helper?
Sure.
Okay.
This would be a good time to mention I've got about 10 minutes before I have to disappear.
Google Sheets helper? I don't know if I like that word helper on there or not. Why can't I click create? I'm wondering. The create is disabled. Do I have to tab out of this to get create to be enabled? Before we see what happens when I tab. What's going on?
Is it because you're not allowed to? Well, no, you should be allowed to put any .NET framework project and application. Is there something already called that in that location? Did you try all of this before we went live?
No. I did not. He likes to fly low and slow. It's Jetson. It doesn't like my location. Should be okay there. I don't know.
I'm missing something obvious. That does seem completely legit to make that.
I'm like kind of stunned at this point.
Does anything change if you shorten the project name? I mean, it doesn't look terribly long, but I know Windows has sometimes had issues with the total length of a path being beyond a certain quantity. But that doesn't look like it should. Yeah.
Let's go back. Hey,
Globosaurus.
Why can't I create it? I don't get this.
Are we running? No, we're not running. Okay.
Nothing's letting me, it's not letting me get past that.
This should be one of the most simple parts of this exercise, adding a new project.
I don't know anymore, Codebase Alpha. Maybe it's not the right thing to do. Wait, it's not that extra piece, is it? No? Why? What's going on? Why can't I do this? I think something's read-only here.
Is it .NET Core? Are we not allowed to put .NET Core in a non-.NET Core projects in a .NET Core solution? Is that even true? I felt like you were allowed to mix them. It was depending on what you'd how you'd reference them was maybe an issue.
You think that's it? Class library. I've got class library .NET framework. Yeah, I don't think there's... Is there really such a thing as a...
There is. These are the ones that you've just used recently, so... You know, there are others. Oh, hang on, what's that thing? Add new project at the top of this, says Google Sheets Helper. What's that phrase up there? That's a filter. That won't help us find anything. Is that just a very strange bug in this dialog? Try just choosing console app, class library as you did before, and going next again. No, that hasn't helped at all. Okay, never mind. Cobus Alpha is saying we want a .NET standard class library.
I'm still not seeing this. You cancel a second.
Studio is just fundamentally against you adding a project to this solution.
Yeah, like what should matter? Like what's going on? I think I've got a variety of project types in this solution anyway.
I mean, I can get that it might not be allowable for certain types of project to reference certain other types of project, but having bugs in a solution should be fine.
Yeah,
right?
I'm just adding it. I don't get this. Right.
Yeah, Jetson, we're not running anything in this copy of Studio. There's a little start at the top there, which I presume would be continue if we had been.
Let's get out of here. Come back here.
Jetson says, shut down, reformat, and reinstall Windows.
Okay.
I'm fairly confident that would work. However, there might be some other things we should try first.
Thanks for being with us so far, Roy. It was great.
No problem.
Got some stuff
I'm
done.
Really actually quite happy, this latest problem notwithstanding, I'm really quite happy with the progress that we made, because to go from nothing to correctly reading one of our own sheets, even in a test project in such a short time, is really good. Proof of concept is brilliant.
What?
That's insane.
What? I don't even get this. Now I'm like, what?
You have reached your maximum number of projects. Please depart.
What is going on?
Sounds
this was
like...
old. It says OK button. Yeah, this should be the create. Yeah, that's old. That's like 3 years old.
Location.
6 years ago.
Can we prove that the path you're attempting to save to is legit? Can you copy and paste that directly into, say, Explorer?
Mm-hmm.
It seems like something we shouldn't have to prove, to be honest.
Yeah, it gets me there. It's right there.
Okay.
Yeah, I just pasted it and hit enter, and there I am. What
is there not enough space on your D drive for some reason?
I got 86 gigabytes left.
So possibly we can fit some more text files on there then. Okay.
Yeah, right there. There's 87.4 gigabytes free. Yeah, I don't get it. I really don't get it.
What happens if you change the location to something stupid like C drive room? Does it suddenly enable at that point?
Yeah, let me try. Hold on a second. Let's create...
it actually goes... ever.
Let's put it there instead. See, I still know. Why is the create button?
You suffix a backslash just because reasons.
You want the backslash?
Yeah, that shouldn't be necessary.
Yeah,
but
it doesn't make any sense to me. Let's browse. You want to throw it over in the C drive?
Well, I'm just wondering, does the box react any differently if we just pick somewhere else?
No,
it's still the last two. I mean, there's two boxes on screen. We've tried changing them both to the most minimal forms of reasonable that we can, and still it's not working.
I feel like this is an intelligence test, and I'm failing. I want to interact with what it's giving me, but that's not the problem, I think.
Is there anything like... I know sometimes... That should never be the case, but I've come across situations where you can't rearrange. Get this. So if you go into a .NET Windows program, WinForms, and you do a message box, you literally stick the tiniest dialogue with an OK button up on screen.
Mm-hmm.
If you leave that up there and you don't dismiss it, you can't drag the tabs in Firefox around. And it's because it's at some global level of weirdness, right? So is there something about the second copy of Studio that you have loaded that is interfering somehow with this? There's no way there should be, but,
I don't think so. But
we're reaching for insane at this point.
All right, let's close stuff down. Let's do that. I've also got a third instance of Visual Studio open here. Shut that one down too. And what the heck? We will shut down this one more time. So I have no instances of Visual Studio running.
Okay.
Let's see if we can confirm that here. Okay, nothing there. Sometimes you see stuff hanging back behind here.
Yes.
Nothing here. I don't see Visual Studio up here. Okay, let's start a new instance, start up instance of Visual Studio. It's the D&D app. I love when Surly Dev has given you a hard time for that statement.
Yeah. Well, like I say, in fairness, it was a modal dialogue, but it really shouldn't have been a system-wide modal one.
Okay, one more time. Hold on, it's still starting up.
You know, the next stage, if this doesn't work, is rebooting your machine, right?
I think it's grief is the next stage of this. Properties, I just want to confirm that our D&D core is a .NET Standard 2.0 class library. So we're going to create another one just like that. That's what we're going to try to do right now. Add new project. Look who's here! It's Backbird! It's like I'm getting all wet on this show.
Greetings, Frackberg. You're just here in time to help us with the most complicated of coding tasks, the adding of a new project, despite Studio deciding not to let us.
So, I want to add a...
I can't say that with a straight face.
Class library, .NET Standard. No create button.
Look at that. I mean... What are you going to do? It's...
Okay, I'm going to give up on this part, Rory.
Okay.
We have tried like a lot of things to get that create button to enable.
Yeah.
Right. I'm like stunned. Really stunned.
I feel like I need to walk away from it and have a think and come back.
Yeah, I'm going to report this so I can get our devs and the Microsoft devs to look at this. I'm going to report the issue so at least I have the time marked. Start. This is kind of on my eardrum side. Let me solve that for you. Boom. Thanks. Let me even drop it down to there. How's that, kids? Alright, so here's the problem. I'm trying to create a new project, and I'm stunned that I can't create it. This button is disabled. Did a search online, found things from a long time ago, nothing new and recent. We tried shutting down, restarting Visual Studio. All these kinds of things. We cannot create a new project for this. It's as if this was a read-only file, maybe. That's about the only other theory we have not actually pursued. which is that solution.
Interesting.
Is read only, which is, what is it? It's the D&D app. It's the name of the solution. It's right here. Will properties tell us if it's read only? Yeah, it's not read only.
Do you have that file open in some other program?
Oh, is it open here?
Like, it's locked.
No, it's not locked. I don't think it's locked. I bet I can rename it. Here, let's see if I can rename it. I can rename it. It is not locked.
Okay.
Let's rename it back.
At this point, we really are reaching for crazy, though, aren't we? Because all the sensible things seem to have been looked at.
Let's try reload. Try one more time. Add the solution. Yeah, we don't... try on taking the Make Visual Studio 2019 really frustrating option. I have unticked that. That option was definitely unticked. All right, one more time. Right click, add, new project, standard, C sharp, Windows, library, .NET standard, next. That button is disabled right there.
I know you don't have too many projects. I've seen solutions with close to 60 plus projects.
Yeah, it would tell me if that was the case. Yeah, that's really weird. Okay, so CodeRush devs, this is highly unlikely this is a CodeRush issue, but I'm marking it here so I can send this on to Microsoft here. Cannot create project. Create button disabled. Let's see what the Visual Studio team says about this. Okay, well, you gotta go, buddy.
Yeah, I've reached that point. I gotta go. I'm really curious to see what happens here, but I'll catch you the same time tomorrow.
All right.
And see what's happened.
We'll see you tomorrow. All right.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye. See you. Okay, so we're not gonna create a new project. Instead, we're gonna come down in here and... we're going to go, let's get our Google Sheets piece. We're going to start working on that here locally inside D&D Core. That's what we'll do. Move it out later. Okay, so we need to do a NuGet. Packages on this. Go out and browse. Sheets. Let's install that. Yeah, Jessup says, must be you. Works on my machine. I haven't tried it, but we'll say works on my machine too. Yeah, well, how do you think we got these other projects here? We added them. Everything was working fine. I might have an older version of Visual Studio. I'll need to check that. There might be an issue there. CSV Reader. Okay, that's all right. Namespace Google. This should be gone because of what we just did. Using directive is unnecessary. What? Can you try if you want disabling any extensions? Maybe some conflict? I only have CodeRush loaded. That's it. And CodeRush doesn't do anything in that space, right? There's nothing it does there. So it's crazy unlikely that CodeRush is causing it. So let's see what's going on here. This version is installed. For DHDM, that's this app. So why are we having a problem here? Oh shoot, I know why. My bad. I installed it into the wrong package. want to install all of these. I can't shift click them. All right. Successfully uninstalled. So I got to do these in a certain order. Okay, probably this one next, I guess. Downloading missing packages. That didn't work. Now uninstall this. Come on. Successfully uninstalled. Wow. A little bit of a mess here. That one's gone. Yeah, definitely have to be installed in the right order. What a mess. Okay, this one, uninstall. All right, back over to the core. Manage NuGet packages. Happening here. Detected package downgrade. Newton soft. Did this just happen? Did not. Comment this out so we get comment this out as well. Let's build. There's the progress bar right there. Okay, build succeeded. One more time. Indy core. Try to install it. Okay. It's because, it looks like it's because of the JSON. Reference the package directly from the project to select a different version. It looks like, if I'm reading this correctly, that Google APIs require Newton Soft JSON 12.3 or above. So it looks like I need to update that. There. Let's see what kind of damage we do here. Actually, let's do this. Let's manage NuGet packages for the entire solution. Okay. Let's install those. Thank you. Okay, now let's go back to browse. We're going to put this in D&D Core. Actually, let's just try one more time. Oh, we got the create button now. Huh. What is going on with that? All right. That's the folder. I want to put it in. Project name, we're going to call this Google Sheets Helper. Super interesting.
Oh,
yeah. Think you may need a reboot. Dude, I just got it. Don't create a new solution. Oh, geez, is that what I did? I said place it in a new solution. Oh, man. That's not what I wanted to do at all. All right, at least I got the thing out there. That was horrible. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Let's go back to the D&D app. Sorry, buddy. You tried to save me. All right, let's add an existing solution. Sorry, add an existing project. All right, we're in. Phew. Okay, now, let's see. I'm gonna drag this off screen here for a second. I'm gonna drag my credentials file down into Google Sheets Helper. Nice, right click it. As soon as I right click it, it opens it. Wow, choose properties, copy always, it's done. I'm pretty sure that was the case. Let me double check it. Right click, did not open it that time. I'm not sure why. Okay, let's bring Visual Studio back up to the front so you can see it. All right, next. Manage NuGet packages. Browse. Sheets. I feel like I'm getting better at working my way through this. There it is right there. Install. Looks like that's good. Okay, go to D&D Core, grab my, it's inside all tables, I think, all items, tables. Google Sheets, there it is right there. I'm gonna take that Google Sheets class, drag it down into my Google Sheets helper. Move it. And let's go inside of Google Sheets. Let's take class one and delete it. All right, here's my Google Sheets. Working our way through it. Let's go find the other app we're working on. Start new instance of Visual Studio. Okay. That's the one I want to open up. Let's get some of that code that we were working on before. I want to change D&D Core to I want to rename Google Sheets Helper to just my Google Helper. Let's rename that. My Google Helper. I'm going to right click it, choose properties. Properties, we'll now choose. Yep, I just want to make sure to rename those as well. Assembly name and default namespace, good. So now Google Sheets is going to be namespace Google Helper. All right, get the file name without the extension. Then what I want to do is when we save the file, doc tab separator. And that's going to be a space dash space. That's what, that's what Google adds when I export a sheet out. So that data file name is going to include that separator on it. So now what I want to do is check to see file name only dot index of doc tab separator is greater than or equal to 0, or greater than or equal to 1, or just greater than 0. Because I need something on the left and right, I can't just check to see if it's greater than or equal to 0. Then we're going to say we need a doc file name is equal to, let's get this, let's introduce a local for this. Substring 0, comma, doc tab separator position. What's everybody doing right now? How you guys doing? Okay, there's my doc file name. Then I need my tab name. And my tab name is going to be file name only. Having fun. All right. That's going to start at doc tab separator position plus that dot length. And I think that's all I need to get the end of it. That's my tab name. Cool. Then I think what I want to do is I want to come right out and I want to say, hey, let's call get, let's do return get of t and pass in doc file name and tab name. Like that. Let's also throw an exception here. Doc tab separator not found. Okay, so there's my exception. I know I should be using a special kind of exception, but I'm just gonna, what is it, least parameter exception, maybe? What is it? Is it invalid? Data exception? I can solve that. I can run with that. Okay. So that's a little bit better. So let's declare this. And we're going to do something here. Error reading Google Sheets. Doc file name. Tab name. Okay. That's cool. I think we got something buildable right there. I'm going to set a breakpoint here, and I want to call it build succeeded. Sweet. All right. So now I want to call this. I want to call it from, let's just go into all players like this. Let's go into our load data, and I'm just going to come in here to Google Sheets.get. Like that. And let's add in the reference to Google Helper. Okay, set a breakpoint here. Just run it and test it. Initialize player data. There's a breakpoint. Step inside. Make sure our string manipulation is correct. There's dnd-players. That's good. The doc name is dnd. And the tab name is players. Sweet. Okay. Let's just kill it. Let's get the next step. So we need to look at our test right here. We use an application name. Where are we using it? Here. It wants an application name. Okay, so we'll do that. It's going to be in a DLL, so it's not really going to be an application name. We'll call it this for now. Hey, Cameron Chicotti, just walked into the office. How you doing? You okay? No? You know you're excellent. Not okay, you're just excellent. You need a kiss to make it through your day? Okay. I will kiss you live on the air in the middle of the show, just slightly off screen, right over here. No, no kissing allowed. All right. That's in terms of service violation, pretty sure. Is his clothes going to work? No smooching on stream, says Codebase Alpha. No smooching.
Now I'm gonna come in.
Now you did it. Jesus, please stop. Please. Oh my God. I'm being pulled off screen.
I hope you come back with like lipstick all over your face.
All right, won't be the first time that's happened. Jensen is like, ew, pudding is sweating it out. Pudding says yes, smooching on stream though.
There you go, pudding. All right. Pudding's
about indulgence. Yeah, you're right. But no terms of service breaking, please. Okay, back over here. Application name. So what are we doing here? User credential. I think we need this. This needs to be, it feels like it needs to be an initialization for the Google Sheets. That's what I'm feeling. I need a static constructor in here. So CCS constructor create static gives me that. Let's paste this in here. Good. Oh, I just realized this, I said read write. I was thinking this was, I only need a read here. I need my read write somewhere else. If I want to be able to write to it. Where's scopes? Scopes is actually, I think, in the other file, I bet. Still. There it is. That's what I needed to change right there, the scopes. Okay. So, let's put it back there. And I'm going to change it right now to spreadsheet, read, write, spreadsheets. See, edit, create, and delete your spreadsheets. Okay, let's try not to delete them. Cancellation token. Where are you, my friend? Mr. Cancellation Token. Looks like that's a using. Okay. Do we agree? Some system threading. Yep. Cool. All right. So there's my initialization, and then I think I need to grab a service and create it. That's what I need to do. And then we're, the rest of this we can work with. All right. So I've done that. Not rename it yet. Let's bring in the rest of the code over. Okay, let's build. Should have just built this project. Would have been faster. Okay, build succeeded. Karen's like, I told you.
Just build it. It's faster.
Just build it. It's faster. Build that one project, right, Karen? Just that project. Okay. What do you think I should do to the method I'm looking at now, though?
Refactor it.
Refactor it? She's always right. Always correct, isn't she? Okay. We've got our service. I'm going to take this and start refactoring it, just like Karen says. That's what I'm going to do. We're going to do that. That's its own method, I think. Well, it's kind of in this space. Right here. Kind of. Yeah, it's on its own method. Hold on. This is going to be read file. All right. We need the spreadsheet ID. And we need to get that spreadsheet ID. I think it's going to look something like this. Spreadsheet IDs. No, it's going to look like this. It's going to be a new dictionary of string index strings.
Okay, baby, are you done by one?
Yeah, I'll be done by one. You got class today? Okay.
I have class every day.
Karen's got class every day. Very classy. All right, this is going to be our spreadsheet IDs. Did I have that on the clipboard? Yeah, there we go. Spreadsheet IDs. Like that. That's our static IDs. We are going to initialize that in our constructor. Let's do an extract method on this right here. What's gonna be extract method? Set up credentials. Get user credentials. Like that. And initialize service. Way better. Code's looking way better. Suppose I could just inline this temp. Way better. Okay. What's on my Clifford spreadsheet IDs? Register spreadsheet IDs. Create that. And then I'm just imagining it's like this, add. And what I want to do, it's kind of like this. I want to, let me copy this to the clipboard. I've just put two markers there. So when I come down and paste it, is that not working? I think I have a code rich bug. That's weird. All right, I've got a code rich issue. Let's report it. All right, kids, we're looking at using multi-select to mark an area that I want to replace. I'm selecting that, copying it to the clipboard, coming to the next line and pasting. And instead of highlighting the area that was in the multi-select, it's like added, what, a tab at the end of this? No, it hasn't even added a tab. It just stuck the caret out there in virtual space. That's issue number one. Issue number two is, with the same code, if I come in here, Control-Alt-Enter there, Control-Alt-Enter there, notice what I've done. I've just created two little multi-select markers. I'm expecting this to give me fields where I can put the caret here and here, right? So I'm copying that to the clipboard, coming down and pasting, and like nothing pastes. Nothing comes in, right? If I copy it without the markers, come down and paste, that works. But put a marker in here, Control Alt Enter. Let's just do one. Does that work? Nope. Let's get rid of the quotes. Does that work? There's a marker right there, paste, that works. The quotes are messing it up. What's going on with that, guys? Take a look, let me know. Let me mark the issue. Hey, Frank's out there. Hey, Frank, how you doing? I was just recording a code rush issue with super mega paste. Super mega copy is actually what it's called. And quotes, that's the bug. Get our devs on that. We are We're dog fooding Code Rush. Every day, Code Rush made by
Gubba Gubba Gross.
And if you don't have a copy of Code Rush, you want one, let me know. Because we are also giving away copies of Code Rush every day. If you want one, it's yours. Just let me know. Downloaded the trial the other day and still need to try it. Talking about the trial of Code Rush? Dude, I hear they do something with new card. What are we talking about? Are we talking about Code Rush or are we talking about something else? Control key. Copy and pasting isn't hard. Did I miss anything? Looks like we're good. Cars? With new cars? I think so. New cars are giving away a brand new car. Yeah, that's right. You every day we give away. Every day we give that away. We're supposed to. And the today's winner is.
You won!
There you go. Go outside into a crowded space to get your new car. I'm kidding. There's no new car here. We're not giving that away. This is getting a little crazy in here, isn't it? Okay. Gotta clean up some house here in my OBS scenes. Did you get your car yet, Pudding? They're nice. Yeah. The way to rub it in, Judson. Good job. Okay, so I want to add the spreadsheet IDs. So here's what I'm talking about on this. For the D&D, let's see. I think all I need is this. So D&D is going to be this number right here. Okay, so we're going to say D&D and give it that number. Boom. I have another table out here. What is it? It's like a D&D table, I think is what it is. D&D table. Right here. And so we'll copy that and give that as well. Put that in here as well. Duplicate line. This is going to be D&D table. And that's going to be its spreadsheet ID. So that means we can use the same syntax that we're using for the file names to come in and reroute it and get that spreadsheet ID. Okay? So. Read file. This is going to get a sheet name. What do you call that? A tab name. That. We need a range. I'm not sure about the range. How we're going to figure this out. Cell range. Spreadsheet ID. We're going to get ourselves. If not, spreadsheet IDs. Dot contains key. Doc name. Then we need something like what we have above here. So we've got doc name, tab name. And we're going to say doc name. Not found. There's our exception. Otherwise, we're going to come in and say spreadsheet ID. Equals. Spreadsheet IDs of docname. Okay, so that gets our spreadsheet ID. Cell range. What's wrong here? It's static. Oh, it's just a case issue. Okay, so there we go. Spreadsheet IDs docked in. Okay, the cell range, we got to figure out how do we get everything, all the data in. Certainly, the syscoders is really good if you invest time in learning shortcuts. Yeah. The YouTube playlist will also help you. Yeah, Frank. So I'm using CodeRush to write code with few keystrokes. So that allows me to kind of talk about it and write it pretty quickly, because otherwise I would just be spending so much time, you know, trying to get everything right. For example, if I want to create a new variable type string, I just have in VS in the space bar, or you use the tab key to expand. So the template language is powerful. If I want to create a new list of strings, I just come in here and type in NL.S for new list of strings, and I get that. So it's like four keystrokes gets me that, saves me a lot of time, allows me to write code pretty quickly. So it's got a template engine, which is fast. It's got a really cool feature called tab to mix reference. Just get in an identifier, hit the tab key to tab around, and you can see all the references. You can hit escape to jump back to where you were automatically. So you can kind of use it to drill down and drill down, dropping these markers, and then hitting escape to collect them on the way back. It's also got a great test runner, a fast test runner in it. What else you got? If you search online, you can find a video of Mark coding with a Guitar Hero guitar. That's right, I connected a guitar to Visual Studio and was writing code using the guitar and templates. And I was actually, there was a contest we did where somebody was competing against me using two hands on a keyboard without CodeRush. I had CodeRush plus the guitar, the Guitar Hero guitar. And I was writing code and they had to see if they could beat me or not. And one person beat me out of a bunch of people who were trying. The one person had been practicing all night though. So in fairness, but that was it. Yeah, we did that and it was a cool contest. It was really fun, but it showed the power of the templates and the power of the navigation, even though I was driving them from the guitar. Right, moving the guitar, you know, the strummer up and down, hitting the different frets for changing different modes, like going from navigation to writing code. The hardest part for me was the naming, because trying to get I created a special interface when I wanted to enter a letter of the alphabet, because there's no, you know, keys on it. So I had to like go get, you know, the letters one at a time. And that was the thing that slowed me down the most. But anyway, it was cool. So there's a lot in there to write code quickly. And that's what's there. Also, Frank, if you get it, here's a resource to you. You can come in and ask for like a custom lesson. I'm happy to stop what we're doing, you know, take a break, show you, answer questions, show you CodeRush, you know, whatever you need to make sure that you're up to speed and you know, getting what you need. Right? So you can go very quickly. So the support should be pretty good. Okay. So what is going on here? My values. I like things being way more explicit here. So it's a list of objects is the values. That's where we get our two-dimensional aspects of it. The row is, so it's a bunch of rows, right? We can think of this as a row right there. That's what's going on there. Do we have an overload on get that doesn't take a range? All right, let's see if we can find this at. Spreadsheet values get. get entire contents of spreadsheet. That could be fantastic. I'll ping you in a few weeks so we can agree on a date. These days I'm not coding much. Okay, no worries, Frank. Anytime. That method, that offer never expires. I want the whole sheet. Hoping to see an example in here. There's only one get. Here we go. Yeah. So the range is empty. That's what it looks like. The range is simply empty. Is what we do. Okay. So let's do this. Cell range, set it equal to empty string. And then what we want to do is we want to say, if we're not at null or empty, that, then we want to say range equals, plus equals, okay, so range is equal to tab name. If cell range is not null or empty, then range is equal to tab name and then cell range. I think that's it. Okay. So if null or empty, then this just means we're going to be reading the entire file. Okay. I'm about to step through the code and we'll see what we get here. Request is there. When we come back from that request, we're going to want to figure out some data from it, is what we're going to do. We'll read that. Request execute. What other interesting things? Ooh, nice. Major dimension. The major dimension of the values. That's interesting. Defaults to rows. That's kind of cool. Did not know that. Interesting to see if range changes on the way back after the response there. I have a feeling it will. Tell me how much data is there. All right, I'm gonna step through it, I think. Oops, read file's not called. Probably step set there. I think it's just going to be, return value is what I think it's going to be. But for right now, we'll just go in there and step through the code, see what it looks like. And then next, we need to create a new instance of T and populate it using reflection, I think. I think that's the direction I'm headed. Initialize player data becomes the breakpoints. It sounds like I need that here in D&D Core. Is what it sounds like I need. Changes in me. Okay, here it comes, clicking initialize player data. Still, come out with file or assembly. Google API Sheets version 4. System cannot find the file or one of its dependencies specified. What's going on here? Thank you. I wonder if it's a versioning issue. I don't get it. I also don't understand this, the warning right here. Yours, Frank. Yeah, I like the emote too. It's super cool. Yeah, I like it. Well, I'm not sure what's going on. I got what looks like a warning on Google Helper here. Check project architectures. I'm not sure what you mean by that. I think you mean like a solution. Any CPU for both. Oh, that's a great suggestion. Let me take a look at that. Any CPU for that one, the D4. Yep, we need CPU for both. Standard class, .NET standard class library. .NET standard 2.0 class library. No problems there. Yeah, it's like, what if it's dependencies? Oh, you know what its dependencies could be? I was thinking we saw the Newtonsoft JSOF dependency, clean and build. You know what, that's actually a great suggestion too. Let's try that. Clean succeeded. Rebuild. Rebuild all succeeded. Let's try a run. We still have those little kind of warning icons though in Solution Explorer. What's going on here? Initialize player data. Yep, same problem. That did not help. I do have this one error here, but it doesn't have anything to do with what we're working on now, it seems. Is the Google API compatible with .NET Standard? Well, I think I would receive some sort of build error, but let's do a check. Is that really my problem? What are these? This is driving me crazy. I'm hovering over them expecting some sort of information on the warning. What's the warning icon on the dependencies? Oh yeah, I'm upvoting that. And I'm avoiding that comment too. Load project dependencies? Okay, also, why not available here? Okay. Let's see what happens. Wait, I thought it was going to do something. It's just opening up the file. I don't understand what's going on here. Oddly enough, my .NET Core 3 projects needed me to simply click load project dependencies from the context of the project. And the warning icon disappeared. Not happening here. Clear all NuGet caches. What is it? Configurations. It's this one? Which one's configurations? No, it's not that one. Settings? That's probably what it is. I have both of those. Click the clear all NuGet caches. Clearing all NuGet caches. So clearing it, I guess. Weird interface right now. I'm like nervous. Can I actually close it? No, I can't. It's disabled. Okay. Clear failed. This the second instance of Visual Studio had the was it the same project open or not? I'm not sure it was. Let's try again. Now we're just right in on that problem. Okay, let's close all instances of Visual Studio down. Time. Kind of interesting, right? Spending a fair amount of time kind of fighting just to get a point where we can write, get to a point where we can write code. Still. Sixteen warnings. Cannot access this file. And I have no other instances of Visual Studio up. I think I'm looking at a restart. Whoa, look at that. Let's kill it. Try again. Could that have been the source of our problems? Quick alert, are we still on the hunt for how to add a new project? No, but other problems with regards to NuGet, really strange problems, but I just found an instance of Visual Studio that was still up and running that was didn't have a window associated with it, but it was out there in Task Manager, so deleted it. Now trying to delete all of the NuGet packages. The cache, I mean. Clear all the NuGet caches. Still. Unable to delete one or more files. Yeah. So, not able to delete. I think I'm looking at a restart. Well, I had that a lot back in the days. Well, I guess I'm welcome to your life now. I think I got to restart this. So I think what I'm going to do, so we tried a couple options on this and have not gotten through it. So, by the way we got through the other one, Rory, is I went and added it, but I mistakenly added it to its own new solution. I thought everything was working. Then I just added the existing project because it was in the right folder where I wanted it to be anyway. Let's go in and see who we can write. see what Cody Live is doing. I don't see Code It Live up here anymore. Is Code It Live not a member of the stream team? So yes, I'm gonna send it to Code It Live. That's what we're gonna do. Start the raid. All right, kids. Well, thanks for hanging out. Tomorrow, I imagine we'll make some serious progress in this. And we'll see you tomorrow.